The next session is CD presentation on eco-guided interventions. I would like to request the chairpersons to come on the stage, please. The chairpersons are Dr. Soumitra Ray, Dr. S.S. Mishra, Dr. Amal Khan. And the first speaker is Dr. Nurul Islam.
Yeah.
The time allotted to us is like that. 6 minutes total time for the presentation. After completion of 5 minutes, there are going to be a buzzer. And we have 2 minutes of time for interaction.
Good afternoon. It's a CD presentation session. Where exactly we are? As it is unknown CDs, so as chairpersons, we don't know anything what is going to happen. But we know that we have to finish the presentation by 5 minutes and the discussion in another 2 minutes. So 7 minutes per presentation, that much as chairpersons we know. So let's see what happens. May I call upon the first presenter, please? Dr. Nurul Islam.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and respected chairperson. It's a topic about zero radiation, a cardiac intervention, a challenge. We all know about the zero calorie. We are very much conscious about the health and figure, and there is Diet Coke, zero calorie, there is a zero figure. And we as intervention cardiologists, we do some of the intervention under complete echocardiography, like bedside balloon atrial septostomy, and sometime in some center, they are very much confident about doing ASD device closure under transesophageal echocardiography. In next couple of minutes, I would like to demonstrate how we did a difficult situation, PDA device closure under complete echocardiography without any radiation. 5 years old boy with a weight of 12 kilogram with a height of 116 centimeter, and he had a large ductus and came to OPD for evaluation. And echocardiographic evaluation wise, there is a PDA of around 4 millimeter, which measured maximum at the pulmonary artery end with continuous left to right shunt with significant volume overload of the left-sided chamber, and there is no pulmonary arterial hypertension, as the gradient was like 100 by 49 millimeter of mercury. So we planned for PDA device closure in cath lab as per routine protocol. Pre-cath investigation was in normal limit, and we took the patient on the lab, but we did a puncture in the groin with a 6 French vena sheath, and we entered the IVC to right atrium, to right ventricle, and almost to the pulmonary artery. So under the pressure guidance, and that is why we reached the pulmonary artery end without using the radiation and using the ionizer. At this point of time, we tried to get a fluoroscopic image, but suddenly it was detected the cath lab machine was not functioning proper way. It was hanged. So the source was at a different place, so we could not use. That time we had a discussion whether we should continue the procedure or we postpone. So after discussing with our respected senior colleagues and cath lab staff, we planned to go ahead and take the new challenge. So after entering into the pulmonary artery end under complete echocardiography, we crossed the ductus under echocardiography image with the use of 025 straight tip pteromere and entered to the descending thoracic aorta, advanced the multipurpose catheter, and we checked the pressure tracing was aortic pressure. So we are very much confirmed that we are in the safe zone. Through this multipurpose catheter, we took the stiff wire, that is the exchange length Teflon wire, placed in the abdominal aorta. As you see, in the abdominal aorta, more echogenic wire is present. After this point, we change everything as per routine protocol only through echocardiographic guidance. And we decided as per the echo findings, the device we took through the 6 French delivery sheath, and the aortic disc was deployed. This is the PDA delivery sheath crossing the ductus. Now the question, how much we should go inside, whether we are in the safe zone or not. So we took the help of the saline contrast study by through the PDA delivery sheath. You see there is a saline contrast. So we thought my delivery sheath will be in the at the level of the diaphragm. From this point, using the suprasternal views, we slowly pulled back the delivery sheath. And we were in the safe zone. We took the device through the delivery sheath. And slowly, slowly, after release of the aortic disc, we pulled back. And it was stuck in the aortic ampulla. And after that, we put a collar on echo. And we saw whether there is any amount of arch obstruction or not, or any residual shunt, whether it is compromising left pulmonary artery or not. But we are, all the findings are very much satisfactory. So we are happy the device in the right position. It is not causing any problem. So after this check echocardiogram, we saw this is the descending thoracic aorta, this is the device, right pulmonary artery, main pulmonary artery cable is still attached to the device. And after that, we released the device, and the device took in a nice place, nice shape, and there is no obstruction in the left pulmonary artery or right pulmonary artery. So in this technique, the PDA device is done across the world, and there is a standard practice of taking both arterial and the venous axis. Now there is a little bit of discussion, or rather controversy, whether should we avoid the arterial axis to avoid the complication related to the arterial puncture in the small babies. So single venous sheath versus classical technique, there is a lot of innovation in terms of the technique, in terms of using the different hardwares through a retrograde or antegrade, and there is also the choice of the interventionalist whether should use the ADO1 or ADO2. So in conclusion, I want to share that echocardiography can be very much helpful in crisis, even you are doing a difficult or not commonly practiced intervention under complete echocardiography, and definitely you need to have very good support group and your colleagues. Thank you very much.
It is open for the question, like if anybody is interested to ask a question.
There are 2 minutes for discussion, as Dr. Islam has nicely finished within his time. So it's open to the audience. We should. If there is no question arising, may I thank Dr. Islam?
I think Vishuji sir wants to ask question.
Please.
I understand this case because the cath lab was not working. But even if the cath lab is working, in which situation will you use only echo for interventions?
So I didn't hear proper, sorry.
In this, your particular case, the cath lab suddenly was malfunctioning. So you did not use fluoro. But in routinely, when the cath lab is functioning, you have the advantage of fluoroscopy, but still you would like to do the echo-guided intervention. What are those, what are the main things? Have you done it any time?
Even the cath lab is functioning, whether we can take under complete echocardiography.
Have you done it any time?
Yes, I have tried, but sometimes I face difficulty. So by that technique, we reduce the radiation time. The main difficulty, when you crossing the ductus and where the main pulmonary artery is dilated, or either the left pulmonary having the smaller dimension. These are the main difficulty. Otherwise, rest of the procedure can be done very safely, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Just call.
We invite Dr. Biswajit Bandyopadhyay from RSS Tagore Hospital. He will present the next case. Is a pediatric cardiologist there?
Okay. Then it will go like this.
So this topic really demanded that what are the indications where we can do echocardiography as the only source. But then to be very practical and helpful for the patient as well as for the physician, I think in the cath lab, you would always like to have little bit of fluoroscopy always, because otherwise your heart is not fulfilled. So, just for the talk, I have arranged these slides. Echocardiography is mobile and real time, an advantage over other advanced imaging modalities like MR or CT. Echocardiography can be recorded at the bedside, in the cath labs, in the cardiovascular ICU, and in the emergency room. And performance of imaging immediately before, during, and after various procedures involving interventions. The usefulness of echocardiography was in transatrial septal catheterization, like when you do transatrial puncture, pericardial synthesis, you don't need fluoroscopy at all, myocardial biopsy, you don't need fluoroscopy, percutaneous transvenous balloon valvuloplasty. It happened to me once. This was a 1 month old child, about 3 kilos. And this child, somehow we could not get an atrial access in both the groins. Tried for an hour and then, but the valve had to be dilated. So went through the venous side and we crossed the PFO. And then through the mitral valve, left ventricle, we went into the aortic valve. So, of course, we had fluoroscopy, but then we didn't have an arterial line. So this was all anti-grade. So what we did was partially inflated the balloon in the aortic valve, and then we saw the echo, whether the valve balloon was correctly positioned in the across the aortic valve or not. And then we used the echo only to dilate the valve and came out of the situation. We were very afraid of that procedure because we did it for, this was quite a few years back, and luckily the child has absolutely no grade across the aortic valve on follow-up. So it really helps sometimes. Now, catheter closure of ASDs and PFOs, alcohol septal ablation for hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and cardiac electrophysiology. These are the situations where echocardiography really helps. So these are the intervention procedures which I told you just now. And general imaging considerations like transthoracic echo is widely available and portable and offers excellent image quality, especially in children. Offers sufficient 2D and Doppler capabilities to guide a variety of interventions such as all the things which I told you. Transesophageal echo offers definitely superior image resolution than transthoracic, excels at assessing intraprocedural anatomy and physiology, monitoring the catheter position and contact, and excluding thrombus, pericardial effusion, and other complications. Intracardiac echocardiography, although we routinely never use this because it is very expensive, and it requires very higher grades of groin sheets. It is comparable with or maybe sometimes superior to TE, but people like me who have been trained with transesophageal and transthoracic, we are more comfortable with transesophageal than ICE. And this needs an extra venous access as well. But there are risks of intracardiac echo, like it can cause real trauma, it can cause cardiac perforation, lot of problems can happen. Echocardiographic guidance of ASD defect and PFO closure is a different approach, primarily fluoroscopic guidance, and you can use echo as a helpful tool. Transthoracic offers multiple planes to evaluate the device and the atrial septum, but it has little bit limited ability to integrate the IVC rim of ASD after device placement. The septum is relatively far away from the transducer in comparison to TE or ICE. Color imaging is suboptimal in larger patients. However, some centers use transthoracic routinely for monitoring all patients. Adult labs typically use TE or ICE. Only 1 minute left, is it? Okay. So I will go to the main presentation. Sorry. Okay, these are some ICE pictures of closure of ASD. Here, this is an ICE picture of a PFO tunnel. This is the echocardiographic evaluation after septal ablation, alcohol septal ablation. It is useful in cardiac electrophysiology. This is a balloon mitral valvuloplasty where you can guide you the exact position of the balloon. This is a pericardial synthesis to guide the needle through which you are doing the pericardial synthesis. And in transseptal catheterization, like this here, where you're doing the transseptal puncture. I'll just require one more minute. So this is a paravalvular leak closure where you can have devices sitting on the, I think my next speaker will show paravalvular leak closure. VSD device closure with ADO2, where you have VSD, perivenous VSD. And then with, can I have the pointer? This pointer doesn't work. So here you can see the ADO2 device sitting on the septum. And subsequently, you can actually, this is a real indication for echo in the cath lab where you don't need fluoro to deliver the device. So here you can see the device nicely sitting there. And then in the short axis view, you can see the one rim on the this side and the other disc on the other side. So here, actually, you got to really helps you in select, I mean, make sure that the procedure is gone all right. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bandhopadhyay, for giving the overview of all the interventions and their indications. Thank you for the nice presentation. And we'll go to the next speaker.
One is in chat.
We invite Dr. Anil Singhvi for the next presentation.
Good afternoon all, it's my pleasure to be back here and thank you everybody including organizers for giving me the opportunity. I'll be speaking two illustrative cases of echocardiographic guided intervention to put some importance to the role of echo in transcatheter intervention.
Slide change please, it's not working.
Not working?
Slide change please. Yes. The first case is a 6-year-old boy, 14 kilo with a functional class 2, having a diagnosed case of AHD from outside, increased cardiothoracic ratio in X-ray, sinus rhythm with RVH in ECG. So the child had multifenestrated ostium secundum AHD with severe valvular pulmonary stenosis, dilated RARV with good function. Next. So we can appreciate in the echo in the 4-chamber modified view, at least 2 AHDs are there. The bigger superior one is 13 millimeter and smaller one is 6 millimeter. The doming pulmonary valve with a significant gradient of 93 with a PA annulus measuring 15. So our plan was doing Bessel hemodynamic on table transesophageal echocardiogram to delineate the holes, RV angiogram, doing balloon pulmonary valvotomy, then crossing the superior AHD under echo guidance, and that was the very crux of the whole procedure. If we are going through the inferior hole, we will not be able to do the procedure correctly. Then balloon sizing of the upper AHD with a 24 millimeter balloon, closing the upper hole, and then confirmation. So this is the transesophageal echocardiogram. In 90 degree view, we can appreciate there are 2 holes. The superior one is bigger one. So after that, we crossed the pulmonary valve and did a balloon pulmonary valvotomy with an 18 millimeter Tyshek balloon. The gradient reduced from 65 to 20. Next, please. So with the superior AHD was crossed with a 4-French Judkins right catheter under fluoro guidance, you can appreciate this is that catheter and it is across the superior border of the defect just near the IVC RA junction. So it confirmed that we are through the right hole. We passed a 24 millimeter sizing balloon through the upper hole, and the occlusion of the hole was confirmed through echocardiogram. So here again, the echocardiogram came to our rescue to tell that we are through right hole and completely occluding without any significant flow. The balloon stretch diameter came around 20 millimeter. So with a 10 French sheath across the upper ASD, so you can again see here, the ASD is basically stretched by the sheath, and now we can see the sheath here. This is that pointer, I am just trying to show the sheath here. So we took a 22 millimeter Amplatz septal occluder and closed the defect. Next, please. So this is the stable device position before release. There is no residual flow, both the holes closed, the inferior hole closed being by the overall diameter of the bigger LA disc. Next, please. So again, in the transthoracic pre-discharge stable position, and the child was discharged on aspirin, doing well on follow-up. The next phase, very quickly, a 54-year-old male smoker, non-diabetic, had acute myocardial infarction, had a distal left main LAD cutoff, angioplasty efforts were unsuccessful, was taken for urgent CABG, and off-pump 3 grafts done. But post-operatively, after initial few days of stabilization, the patient deteriorated. He was put on IABP and dilated heart with parahilar congestion. Was attributed to large post-myocardial ventricular septal rupture. You can appreciate this is that post-myocardial VHD. So we took for the urgent LV angiogram. There was significant post-MI VHD. We crossed the VHD making an AV loop. This crossing of the wire again was helped. We confirmed through the transesophageal echo, this is that catheter across that VHD. Next, please. So we closed it with a 24 millimeter post-MI VHD closure. And this echo again came to our rescue to tell the margins are well caught and no residual flow. So the key are detailed preoperative echo is essential for planning the procedure. Intra-procedure echocardiogram is very important component for guiding the structural intervention. Some interventions are heavily dependent in acute echocardiographic guidance like multiple ASD closure or balloon atrial septostomy. And in any septal defect closure also, the echocardiogram is essential. So with a good intra procedure echo, we can increase our efficacy for the success. Thank you.
Yes. So it's open for the audience for 2 minutes.
Dr. Sarkar, would you like to comment anything? You have been doing these things regularly.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Dr. Devika Chatterjee. Next presenter.
Thank you, chairpersons, and good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to show you a case of device closure of mitral paravalvular leak under echo guidance. I am not an interventionist. My role was just as a guide to navigate the interventionist in the process, in the procedure of device closure of mitral paravalvular leak. Mitral paravalvular leak is a serious and very well-known complication after the surgical prosthetic valve replacement, happens secondary to inappropriate sealing of the swing ring to the native cardiac tissue. It's more common in the mechanical mitral valves with an incidence of 7 to 17% in comparison to aortic prosthetic valve leak of 2 to 10%. In echocardiography, prosthetic valve leak looks like a dehiscence outside the sewing ring. This is the sewing ring which the surgeon stitches with the native cardiac tissue, but if we look here, there is a gap, and color flow confirms the paravalvular regurgitation from the dehiscence. The most of the paravalvular leaks are mild. The patient remains asymptomatic, and we detect it in the regular echo. But if it is a large and clinically significant paravalvular leak, it needs closure. Traditionally, surgery has been the treatment of choice, but nowadays, percutaneous transcatheter device closure is done. It is a novel alternative and gives a very good result in selected patients. It is done with the muscular VSD device occluder by the interventionist. There is a great role of echocardiography during the device closure of paravalvular leak, starting from its initial diagnosis, selection of the patient suitable for the device closure by characterizing the location, number, size, circumferential extension, and also a great role during the intra-procedure guidance. But we must not forget that echo is prone to artifact from prosthetic shadowing because we get a lot of reverberation, shadowing, etc. Our case is a 40-year-old female who had mitral valve replacement and aortic valve replacement with mechanical prosthetic valve a year back, came to us with new onset SOB in OHA class 2 to 3 and palpitation for 2 months, no history of fever. On auscultation, normal mechanical heart sounds, but there was a new onset pansystolic murmur. Her INR was at therapeutic level, WBC count was normal. So in transthoracic echo, it is focused in the mitral prosthetic valve. If you see the color flow, there is a flow at the outside the sewing ring, and it measures around 6 millimeter. The transesophageal echo is the method which we use for assessment and during the procedure. By doing the transesophageal echo, we inspect the valve in multiple planes starting from 0 degree to 180 degree. We exclude a thrombus in the LA and LA appendage. This is the mid-esophageal view of a bileaflet mitral prosthetic valve, where we can see the good excursion of the both the discs, but if we see carefully, this is one end of the sewing ring, it is intact, whereas here in this side, there is a dehiscence. And when we put the color flow, this is the flow across the valve with small Walsh jets. These are normal for a prosthetic valve, but as we try to look on the lateral side, this is the regurgitation outside the sewing ring. Again, we measure it again and again so that we get an idea what should be the size of the device closure. The interventionist selects the size of the device. So again, we see this is the paravalvular leak, and it measures around 5 by 5 millimeter. Though we get a lot of information by 2D transesophageal echo, but it is the 3D transesophageal echo which allows us better definition of the size and the shape of the paravalvular leak. This is the zoom view of mitral prosthetic valve. This is the sewing ring. If you see carefully, there are the two discs opening and closing. And if we see, this is the paravalvular leak. And to know the relation of the defect with the surrounding tissue, this view is rotated by 90 degree counterclockwise in the Z axis so that here lies the aorta. This is the surgeon's view. Mitral valve lies here and anteriorly aorta. And on the left side of the surgeon is the left atrial appendage. So I know the defect is in at 11 o'clock position, and I tell the interventionist. There are two approaches for the closure: anterograde by transapical puncture and retrograde by transapical puncture. The interventionist who has done this closure used a combined approach of anterograde and retrograde puncture to make a LV apico-venous loop for the easy passage of the Can I use?
How long?
1 minute?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Okay. So for the easy passage of the device delivery sheath, during the procedure, we also do the T to make the septal puncture, apical puncture. We guide the smooth travel. We ensure the adequate positioning and identify the complication of the procedures. As the interventionist was doing the transseptal puncture, I have shown him the septum and measured it so that he, to ensure that there is enough space for the hardware to maneuver. During the apical puncture by a transthoracic echo, I show him the distance of the apex from the chest wall, and he takes the terumo wire, and he passes it to the paravalvular leak, goes to the left atrium, which is snared through the septal puncture, and then the sheath is brought to the venous root, and it is positioned. As soon as it is positioned, this is the mitral valve, this is the aortic valve, here is the leak, and the device is, he is trying to position it, and he is trying to release it. So I check the echocardiography. There is a small mitral regurgitation. Now, just after the release deployment of the device, again I recheck, and there is no residual MR from the paravalvular leak. So if this was before the procedure, where is the leak, this is during the procedure with the catheter, and this is the after the closure. It is absolutely closed, no residual flow. So, and that apical puncture was closed with a vascular device. So to conclude, I'd say that successful closure of paravalvular leak begins with efficient imaging, including the selection of the case, detection, and also during the procedure, it compares the pre and intra-procedural results. But a very good team spirit is necessary to good, we have to have a good communication between the echocardiographer and the interventionist. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chatterjee. I'm sure the whole audience was eager to comment on your presentation, but as there is no time, thank you very much. Thanks for the beautiful presentation. May I call upon the next speaker, Dr. Amitabh Chatterjee, on the stage, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, the organizers, for letting us talk on this August forum. I have the main intervention which I am going to show you, the balloon atrial septostomy, which seemingly is a very easy procedure, but in plenty of countries, it is done as a bedside procedure. So this is a transposition of the great arteries with a low saturation of the 60s. The newborn baby has come just to our NICU. And after confirming the anatomy, there is a pulmonary arteries arising from the left ventricle, and the right ventricle is giving rise to the aorta. We go inside. So here, the balloon atrial septostomy catheter can be introduced through either the umbilical vein or through the femoral vein, and the catheter has been introduced and inflated. The main thing which the echocardiographer has to show on this side, standing on the left side, we have to be a little bit of an ambidextrous, because the main performer or the, interventionist stands on the right side, and you have to show the whole echo from the left side. And you have to show the whole echo from the left side of the patient so that you have a little bit of a space, because you have to show on the patient's tummy, and the space between the groin and the tummy is very less. So here the balloon is inflated inside the left atrium cavity proper. You have to avoid the left atrial appendage, the mitral valve, and other surrounding structures like the pulmonary vein, and the balloon has to be aborted against the atrial septum. Now you can see that the PFO has been made bigger, and after that one, the balloon has to be reintroduced for the second time. So it's a challenge, because you have to guide through this septal perforation. So you have to guide the interventionist from that view. And as you can see, the balloon has been inflated again and it is abutted against the atrial septum, and the pull is being made so that immediately the atrial septum can be, perforation can be made bigger. And here is the pull. When you give the pull, immediately you give the pull and come to the IVC and take the catheter again back to the right atrium so that the IVC is not blocked. So that's the standard things which we do, and you pull with your wrist, not with the elbow. That's done. And this is the atrial septal perforation which you have done, and which measures about, so there is unrestricted flow through the balloon atrial septostomy, and the saturation of the patient has gone up from 65% to about 86%. And on the, after the procedure, the measurement is around 6 millimeters. If I have some time, I'll show you one more thing. This is a ductal stenting. This is an echo-aided procedure, not a totally echo-guided procedure. The diagnosis starts in the fetal life. This lady came to us at 24 weeks of gestation, and we did a fetal echocardiogram. As you can see, there is a small VSD, and I could trace only one great artery coming out from the left ventricle, that is the aorta, overriding the VSD, and the pulmonary artery was not seen. So this was basically a ductal, this was basically a pulmonary atresia, and this is the arch flow. And the fetus was, the delivery was planned in our center. This is the echocardiogram at birth, where you can see there is a valvar pulmonary atresia, and the PDA is flowing inside the duct, maintaining the saturation of the baby. So after this initial stabilizations, this was the understandings, this was the views we already have seen. This is the duct, which is, this is a vertical duct which is coming down from the arch. These views are important because, number one, we have to access the, for the access, we took a femoral venous access, femoral arterial access, and at the same time, we took a left-sided, left subclavian access to gain entry into this vertical duct. So these estimates also led us to the calculations how long the stent should be. Usually the stent, length we take is around between 18 to 25 millimeters. Otherwise, because some of the stent should be protruding inside the aorta and some of the stent should be protruding inside the pulmonary artery. Otherwise, both the ends might cut off. So these are the estimates which we had made, and these are the lengths which we had measured about the stent length and the stent diameter. The stent diameter we measured about 3.5. After the procedure, apart from the angiograms, I have two echocardiograms to show you. This is the whole length of the stent, which you can see here. And this is the whole length of the stent, along with, this is the stent in cross section, along with good flow through the ductus into both the parenchymal pulmonary arteries. So the child is not dependent on the PDA anymore and not dependent on the prostate anymore. So the ductal stenting has been done. Thank you very much.
Thank you for finishing in time. Any questions from the floor? Tripani? We have 2 minutes in hand.
Any comments, clarification, experience, sharing, anything? Okay, then.
Okay, our last speaker is Dr. Anirudh Dande. He needs no introduction. He is going to show another speech also.
While sitting the laptop, till now we have seen that all the interventional cardiologists actually taking the help of the echo to do it. Now let's see how we can help the clinician by echo-guided interventions. This is a very common things we do it. This is the echo-guided pericardiocentesis, day-to-day practice, and what we need to know. See, we often find this type of patient in our day-to-day life, either in the ICU or in the CCU or in the emergency. You can see, to refresh our knowledge of the pericardial tamponade, you can see there's nothing to see, only the photograph. You can find all the features of the whatever written in the book in a single picture. Diastolic flow variation in that is with the respiration, swinging of the heart within. So these are all the features of pericardial tamponade. So these are the features, to summarize it, is the evidence of pericardial tamponade. Mind it, these echocardiographic signs often precede the clinical sign and assist in early therapeutic intervention. And echocardiographic guidance to pericardiocentesis to reduce complication, look at optimal needle entry where fluid is closest to the body surface, This tap is usually done for therapeutic purpose. Diagnostic tap is not usually done. Emergency drainage is needed only for patient with hemodynamic compromise. But the cardiovascular consequence of the pericardial, any pericardial effusion depends upon the amount of fluid, we know it, the speed with which it accumulates, and the patient's physiological reserve. And the cardiac tamponade represent the decompensated phase of the cardiac compression. There is absolutely no contraindication. The optimal approach to the pericardial drainage depend upon the patient habitus, the distribution of the pericardial fluid, and the availability of the ultrasound. Echocardiography is the most common means of confirming the pericardial effusion, enables safer and more reliable percutaneous drainage compared to blind approach. However, mind it, blind pericardial drainage may be necessary in the dire circumstances. You have to do it even without waiting the pericardial ultrasound machine. So this is the subcostal approach. You can see the needle tip very beautifully. Sometimes you not be able to see the needle tip. Now here I can give you an example. Here is the pericardial effusion. We have measured the habitus. We have the measure closest to the surface. How to look at the needle and how it actually look like, I'll say step by step. This is the step where you can not still look at the needle. The next picture, you can see the needle very nice, just peeping into the pericardial cavity, but not yet entered. And in the third stage, it's entered into the pericardial cavity. Now, you have to be careful again, because if you go deep into the clot you are seeing, you sometimes, the needle mouth maybe get clogged. So that can be also seen even while doing the procedures. Now, sometimes you can zoom it and you can see the needle very beautifully. And if the angle is properly corrected, sometimes you can see the absolutely longitudinal way of seeing the needle entering into the pericardial cavity. Now, if you put some contrast, then it will be all immediately filled the pericardial cavity, and you can show that you are in the pericardial cavity. So there is no doubt about it. But it is not always so. Sometimes you may puncture the left ventricle and enter into the ventricle, and that can be confirmed very beautifully by the putting in some contrast, either air bubble contrast or even the myocardial contrast. See, in this case, you are entering directly into the needle, directly gone into the RA-RV junction and filling both the RA and RV. In the next case, again, it got into the LV. So, sometimes when you just not able to pick up that needle has entered or not, put a little bit contrast, you are sure you are in the pericardial cavity. So, this way, you can echo document whole of the drainage procedures of pericardial centrosis. Not only that, you may sometimes find there is a lot of pericardial effusion and there is a localized hematoma because of the rupture of the heart. In this case, you need an echocardiographic guidance to drain the pericardium immediately to salvage the patient. So now, So what I wanted to tell you, the audience, very important is that there are subcostal approach. Because of the time, I'll not give detail of the approach, but there is subcostal approach. This is the actual the way we did it. Parasternal approach we do not do nowadays, but we sometimes have to do the apical approach. I told you according to the patient that I have mentioned, and this is the apical approach. But to summarize it, there is a multiple observational studies of eco-guided pericardiocentesis report improved safety, clinician satisfaction, and success more than 97%. And ultrasound remained the principal diagnostic test to confirm the critical pericardial effusion and should always be used to guide aspiration when available. Prepare the patient and assemble the necessary equipment. Using ultrasound, determine the presence and distribution of the pericardial fluid. Systematically examine the heart, look for effusion at each imaging window, subcostal, parasternal, apical, and any other additional view you prefer. Select the best entry site. The site contains the largest pericardial fluid accumulation that is closest to the body chest wall can be entered without puncturing any adjacent vital organs. Select a target fluid layer, that is the distance from the pericardium to epicardium of at least 1 centimeter to avoid the cardiac puncture. Aspiration of fluid does not always confirm pericardial drainage. Similarly, withdrawing of bloody fluid may represent hemopericardium or accidental cardiac puncture, which can be difficult to discriminate. Ultrasound localization of the needle tip is sometimes, I feel difficult. Then is the bubble contrast injection. Through exploring the needle, detection of the tip easier and helps to calm the needle position. Layering of contrast outside the heart confirms pericardial localization. And the rapid contrast washout, what we have seen in the RVNLV, is or intracardiac swelling, both signify myocardial perfusion. This complication is very less than 2%. So I must conclude here to thank.
1 minute left for audience interaction. Orunangshu, please.
Excellent presentation. But I tell you where the nightmare for pericardiocentesis is. In a cath lab, you are doing a procedure. You did a stent or you did an inadvertent puncture of the coronary sinus and you have a pericardial effusion. This is an acutely developing pericardial effusion.
Absolutely.
Where only 10 ml of fluid can cause a tamponade. The introduction of the needle becomes very, very difficult. Did you have a case like this where how to introduce the needle because the patient is collapsing, you are having a cardiac massage going on because and the blood pressure is in hypotension. How can you get the needle in the right place? Do you have any?
Yeah. Actually, I have the slides, same slides. See, the localized cardiac tamponade is often very difficult to detect even by the echocardiography. But if you very carefully examine in a setting, particularly in the post-operative setting, you find sudden shock, sudden hypotension, then you must look at the particularly under what you told is the right atrium where even the 10 milliliter or 20 milliliter fluid accumulation can cause tamponade. But if you can, here also you can put a little bit of contrast to find out whether in the pericardial cavity, and then even 10 to 15 milliliter aspiration can save the patient and save the patient to re-enter into the operation theater again.
They always this tamponade happens when the accumulation is acute.
Yes, and it depends upon the acute, the amount of fluid and the time.
One thing I would like to ask you, that in absence of features of tamponade, if you can delineate the amount of pericardial effusion, it is mild or moderate, then it becomes difficult for pericardiocentesis. If it is a huge pericardial effusion with features of tamponade, then pericardiocentesis may be less harmful or less risky. But problem arises when there is minimum pericardial effusion, whether in the doubt whether you want to drain it or not. Usually subcostal approach we always are doing for a long time. We avoid other approaches. We usually put a wire over, J wire over the needle, and immediately put in this pigtail catheter, and we decide that what amount of pericardial synthesis has to be done in some few hours or immediately or not. In absence of tamponade, it is a very difficult decision to take that whether to put in a catheter over there for some time or whether to give it in a subcostal approach or some different approach.
Yes, sir. I'll give you the two important things. I remember in about 2 to 3 years back, I was called in the emergency. An automobile accident came and we did the echocardiography. And there is a mild pericardial effusion. The patient was in shock.
But that caused tamponade.
Mm-hmm. We take only 30 milliliter fluid with the pericardiocentesis and the patient was salvaged. and then we did the reading. There are multiple injury, and this case was, I presented in many areas.
And to take out this 50 ml fluid is very difficult.
Yeah, that need you echocardiography intervention. Echocardiography. Without echocardiography, you cannot do it. Or whatever the chronic, okay, I finished because organizer is in.
Hello, just one comment.
Thank you.
Dr. Anirudhade, just one comment. Regarding this, what you told, echocardiographic guidance of pericardiocentesis, when you reach the myocardium, one thing we most of us miss is an acute ST elevation. That should be seen on the monitor because of the injury that you caused to the myocardium is a very important sensitive marker that your needle has struck the myocardium. So apart from what…
I fully agree with you.
Munna, many a times during emergency you miss that thing.
I understand.
Many a times there are ventricular extrasystoles appear in the ECG monitoring.
But it is one during important marker that
during the myocardium.
Thank you, Dr. D. And
thank you all the presenters for their very brilliant exposition of the subject they have been allotted. Thank you.
Thank you, respected chairpersons.